standing by.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to an incredible start here, your sunset safari. There the sun is not quite setting, but the golden light of the African afternoon is starting to fall here, and we're sitting with the Queen of Juma, Karula, the 12-year-old female leopard, and it is a great joy to share her and the life of her two little cubs with you. My name is James Hendry. On camera today is David. Hello, David. Well done. And on the other vehicle, we've got Bertie, and he is being filmed today, I think, by William. That's correct. William Durenbrock. And I'm, of course, being completely facetious. It's Byron and Viam on the other vehicle. In the final control, we have Rebecca being ably assisted by, not Louise, by Chelsea Byrne of Vermont. Now, you are most welcome. You are on a live safari, like I say. And I hope that your screenshots of this magnificent scene are slightly better than the utterly appalling photograph I just took, which is more blurry than if you'd been swimming in the sea with your eyes open for the last 2 years. And I also hope that you'll make lots of comment, ask us many questions over the course of the next 3 hours. The way to do that, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions at wildearth.tv. That'll be the best way to get rid of us. And not I'm not sure where that comes from. That'll be the best way to get hold of us. That is horrendous. I've lost my mind. And Byron at the moment is off in the far east, northeast, near Biffleshook Dam. There were reports of wild dogs there this morning, and he was desperately trying to find them earlier on. He's now doing that now, and with any luck, he'll have some good news for us. We, of course, are going to stay here for as long as we can with Karula and her youngsters. That is George that you can see over there. The little one, of course, Karula, the queen, she is the one eating, the big one. And Charlotte, the other cub, is just off to the right-hand side. Sorry, I'm in your way, I think. Sorry about that, David. Do forgive me. Very difficult to see my monitor from where I'm sitting here. And there she is. She's just looking around. Now, this morning, see how alert she is? This morning, that kill was up in a tree, and it wasn't very easy either for the cubs to feed on it, and it wasn't easy for her. I think it was uncomfortable. And I don't know, I think she pulled it up in the night, maybe to avoid hyenas. I suspect quite strongly that one of these cubbies dropped it out of the tree by mistake. And she's decided against taking it back up, simply because it's daytime now, and I suppose the security of the light that is afforded here, and the heat, which is going to sort of deter the other predators from being too mobile at this stage. Yeah, has left her much more comfortable with the feeding here on the ground. And look at the little one. I don't know if you can see there. The little one is getting very cross with her mother. She was hissing just now. He was hissing just now, sorry. It is a balmy 25 degrees Celsius, 77 degrees Fahrenheit. The wind seems to be blowing from the northwest. And that's the kind of warm winds that we get when they turn and they come from the southeast. It gets a bit cooler. And I think we're in for a stunning afternoon if we can spend some time here. And you can just see the lovely white flicking tail there of the queen. And it almost is a sign of sort of surrender to the birds that might come an alarm call at her. Isn't that fantastic? Now, I will get you a view, I hope, of Charlotte over the course of the next little while, but I think let's just sit here. And just remember, while we sit here, we had an unbelievable morning today. We had a lions on a kill, on a buffalo kill, and that was around the Vuyatela Dam. We had elephant herds, we had buffalo herds, we had these incredible leopards. And we're hoping for a similar kind of afternoon, but perhaps topped off with some magnificent wild dogs. But for me, a leopard in the afternoon is the best. They're just not quite so sleepy as many of the other cats, and so there's likely to be a little bit of action while we're here. Let's head across to Byron. He's at Biffleshook Dam. Find out what his plans are, and I'll see you shortly.
Good afternoon, everybody. Great to have you with us again. I am at Biffle's Hook Dam. My name is Byron, and with me this afternoon on camera, I have Viam. Afternoon, Viam. So we are currently trying to look for any signs of wild dog. There were reports of them crossing into this area this morning, but up until now we've had no luck, but I'm still going to have a good look. We have got a hippo in the dam at the moment. Enjoying the cool water. It's a very, very warm afternoon, beautiful afternoon. And hippo is just trying to stay out of the sun, relaxing in the waterhole. Some Egyptian geese behind it, you can just see in the frame. It's interesting, that hippo is a little bit exposed. Now in summer, when we have a little bit more rainfall, the water should be a lot deeper, and the hippo prefer that because then they can submerge completely and just keep their heads above the water so that they can breathe. You notice how those eyes and ears are all situated on top of the head, and that allows them the ability to keep the body under and just those parts of the head out of the water, the vital organs that they need out of the water. But now in winter, when it's a lot cooler, they don't mind being a little bit exposed. They have got very sensitive skin, but the winter sun is not as harsh as the summer sun. So they don't mind being a little out in the open like that. And often what you may find is hippo do enjoy basking in the sun. They'll lie on the banks of a river or of a waterhole just to warm up during the day. The water, obviously, the temperature does drop quite a bit. So they'll warm up in the sun and then return back to the water later on. And in the evenings, they move out of the waterhole and go off and feed. So we're going to carry on checking around this area. Hopefully, we have some luck of the wild dog. I haven't seen any sign of them just yet, but I'm not giving up. We're going to look very, very carefully and make sure, or if they have moved out of the area, we want to be sure of that. And while I do that, James is still with that beautiful leopard and her cubs. Cross over to him and see what they're up to.
Everybody, we're just easing into position, Dave. Tell me when. How's that for you? Because I can see the little one here right below us. Okay, and then the other two, obviously the other side there. Right, I'm going to talk very quietly. We're very close now. This little one is only about 2.5. Maybe 3 meters from us. No, maybe 5 meters. That's pretty close by. And then, just across and to the left, we've got Karula and the other one. That's George. There he is. Hello, Georgie boy. Isn't he lovely? I can't believe how lucky we are. Bethany, thank you for your question. I don't know the answer exactly. You say, is this the first time that Karula has had opposite sex cubs? I was of the impression that the litter before quarantine in Konuma were the same sex. At least were opposite sex, sorry. So I don't think that this is the first time she's had opposite sex cubs. But I might be wrong. And there are many sort of Karula experts on the web. You might even find on her Facebook page, but I think that she had two, a male and a female, before quarantine in Konuma. This is just unbelievable. That's actually Charlotte sitting with her. That's Charlotte you're looking at there, I think. I think their eyes are changing color. And Brooklyn, you're just 10 years old. Hello, Brooklyn. You know, these leopards are, you say, do they drink milk anymore? They don't, Brooklyn, and they're too old now, and you're 10, and these are, I guess, the equivalent of about, say, a 6 or 7 year old human being. They'll be at your age at around 10, it's probably only about a month's time. So they definitely are not suckling anymore. They're a bit old. They stopped almost 2 months ago. Remember, they will be 5 months old on the 2nd of July. And that's pretty soon. It's in a couple of days. Oh, this is just unbelievable. I can't believe how lucky we are to be here. Everybody, we're on our own here, no one else trying to come here. And we're sitting with Karula, the queen, and her two little ones, oops, and rolling into the drainage line. Davy, can you, have you got a view of the one down there? Now, Wendy, you ask a great question to which I don't really have an answer. You say, is there a pecking order at the kill amongst the cubs? And I don't know. I can't remember the last time I watched cubs play so little together. These chaps don't seem to be playing a great deal with each other. And I don't know why that should be the case. I find it a little bit strange. So is there a pecking order? No, I don't think so. I think it's probably just decided by the size of the cubs. But at the same time, I find it odd that they are not with each other more and they don't play more than they do. Seems very strange to me. Isn't that amazing? And she's eating just like an adult. Or he's eating just like an adult. And using those carnassial teeth. So all mammals have milk teeth. Like you had milk teeth or your baby teeth. And so I think they start to fall out at roughly 8 months. I think. And so he will be eating with his milk teeth. And his milk teeth are just smaller versions of the adult teeth, and you can see using the side of his mouth to cut the meat off the bone there. This is just, people, I cannot tell you how lucky we are to be here, watching these special, special cats. Eating away, private as you like, no one else here. Hello, James Dungan, great name that you have. You say, is this the same Steenbok? I have to tell you that I made a mistake this morning when I said it was a Steenbok. It's not a Steenbok. It is most certainly a duiker. Well, it was a duiker. What remains of it is a duiker. And it is the same one that she killed yesterday sometime, around about this time yesterday. Because there were impala going crazy in this area. They were alarm calling. Lex and Aubrey were looking around this area, seeing if they could find anything. They found nothing. And then eventually she popped out in the afternoon as the sun was going down, leading her little cubs up here. So I think she killed the thing. She put it under a weeping wattle bush just sort of behind where we are now. And then she went back to fetch the cubs, which I've obviously been on this reserve, so they haven't been south of us. We've assumed they were south of us, but they've been on the reserve because she certainly didn't fetch them from south of us. And then she brought them back here, and they fed on it for a little while last night, and when we arrived here this morning, the kill was in the tree just above us. And now they're still feeding on it. And I suspect if they are still here this evening, she'll put it back into one of these trees up here so that the hyenas can't have a go at it. And so that should they need to, the cubs can eat in safety. And Dave, if you go back to the other one, she seems to be biting her mother. Just playing with mum. Isn't that nice? And Roger, you're in Florida, and you say, how much longer until they have to be independent? Roger, they won't go independent probably for Female, probably about 18 months she'll go. She will be gone by the time she's 18 months. He will probably hang around about 18 months, maybe up to 2 years, though. So they've got a bit of time left with their mum. But then they will have to forge their own path. And, you know, they're by no means safe. They by no means have an easy path through life from here. It's really not easy for them at all. Do you want to try and go forward? I'm just going to depress the clutch slightly, everybody. Hold on tight. Don't let go. Say when. There we are. Oh, look at that. Well spotted, David. Isn't that awesome? Yeah, wow. Now, leopards can go more independent earlier than that if they have to. A classic example, of course, being young Sandile, who was forced to go early because he ate that rabid dog. Now, I don't know if you've been, how long you've all been watching, but Shadow's other grandson, who's called Sandile, ate a rabid dog, or caught a rabid dog, earlier on this year, and he had to go into rehab. And he was only just over a year old when that happened, and he's been re-released into the wild, so he's now just about 21 months old. And he's managing somehow to survive absolutely fine, despite the lack of mentorship from the mother that he had. And so, you know, leopard cubs can go independent much earlier than the textbooks will tell you. And we know, for example, that there was a leopard in this area once who went independent at 8 months. Now, that's just 3 months from now. And it was a female, obviously. The males are much less good at that sort of thing. The males tend to be fairly poor at going independent, a bit like human beings, of course. They like the comforts of home. They like having mum around to cook them a meal, or in this case, kill the madaika. Oh, it's wonderful. Isn't this a little bit of fluffy white fur on the belly? This is how an afternoon on a Tuesday should be spent, I feel, David, don't you? Tuesday afternoon. Quite happy not to have a desk job. Yes. Wee George still eating his meal. All right, let's go quickly across to Byron, get an update on his tracking expedition, and we'll be right back here.
So, unfortunately, no luck just yet. I've had a good walk through this area. No wild dog, no sign of any wild dog. I saw their tracks from this morning, but it's very difficult to gauge which direction they've moved off. Just going to drive around this area a little bit more, once more, just have a good look. But I don't seem to see any sign of where they are. That's how it goes. Often wild dog, you know, we left them or lost them this morning at about 9 o'clock, so they were still very active. So, good afternoon, Corey, and welcome to your co-workers. Tori and Tracy are joining us for the first time. It's great to have you on the afternoon safari with us, our sunset safari on Safari Live. So, Tori and Tracy, Corey has asked me to explain to you what you can expect from a safari and if you come out on a safari. So, usually what happens is we have two drives during the day. One in the early morning and one in the afternoon. The reason for that is that this is a time when a lot of the animals, or most of the animals, are active. It's nice and cool temperatures, and you may still get a lot of predators moving around. The reason for that is they were possibly still hunting from last night. A lot of the predators are nocturnal, like lion and leopard. And then with those cool conditions, you do get a lot of bird life active, and the animals are still moving around quite a bit, especially now in winter. In the mornings, the predators do tend to move around a lot longer during the morning, as opposed to summer when they will go and rest and relax in the heat of the day. So we're busy looking for wild dogs at the moment. We had a report of them around this dam this morning, this Biffles Hook Dam, but I unfortunately cannot see any sign of them. We came and looked, but as I said, it was about 9 o'clock we got to this area and it was still cool, so they would still have moved around quite a bit. But you never know, we could always bump into them. On what else can you expect on a safari? You can usually expect some afternoon snacks if you go on an afternoon drive, or morning tea and coffee with biscuits while you're out in the bush. It's a really nice time to stretch your legs, get out. Your guide will show you some of the smaller things around while you're walking. And then while you're driving around, hopefully spot a lot of wildlife, and you've got that interaction with the guide, and you can hear and see everything that he does, and then ask a lot of questions while you're out. I hope that answers your question about what to expect on a safari, but I think the best is if you come out and experience it for yourself. We're going to carry on just checking around this area for a brief while, see if we don't see any sign of these wild dogs. While I do that, head back to James with that beautiful leopard.
Now, it's not a very bad thing that Byron hasn't found those dogs yet, I tell you, because all tracks of them, because it probably means that they've gone to sleep somewhere on this reserve. If you check the eastern boundary and the northern boundary and the tracks have not gone across, there's a very, very good chance that they're lying up in the shade and that they will start to move as it gets a bit cooler. So if he hangs about that area, we might be very lucky. So let's be patient, as Byron is no doubt being patient. And let's hope that he manages to find the dogs as they come out for the evening. Here comes the queen. The queen is now moving down into the shade, coming back towards the kill. And while you were gone, young Georgie over here, who's now getting very cross with his mum, he's pulling his ears back and going while he were away, he picked that Geiger up, and it must already weigh, like we were discussing this morning, it probably weighs about twice what he does. Now the queen is just down there, you can see her. I'm just trying to stay out of the way. She's right in front of us here. I'm going to talk very quietly now. She's just over there. There's the little one calling. Did you hear that? Going, I think that was Charlotte calling her. Charlotte is now coming down towards the kill. Karula is very close. She's turned around. She's going down there. Sorry, David. There's not much I can do, I'm afraid. Ah, now she's gone to sleep right in the deep shade there where we have absolutely no view of her. So let's just watch Georgie boy. Kathy Stewart, a nice question from you. What would I do if these cubs approached us and tried to interact with us? I think at this stage, Karula is comfortable enough not to worry. So I've certainly been in situations where leopard cubs become so comfortable with the vehicles that they walk under the car, lie down under the car, in exactly the same way perhaps you've seen the hyena cubs do. And they'll become that comfortable with us eventually. And I think she's okay with that. You know, if we didn't move too much while that was happening, and if we sat still and we didn't sort of give the cub a fright, I think she wouldn't have an issue with it. Look, look. Davey, I don't know if you can see. She's so close to me. I'm just going to get out the way. There, you can see the tail. Now, Kathy. Making a noise. There, look, 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 going up the tree. She's only 2.5 meters from us. Look. And Kathy, as I say that, I'm keeping an eye on Karula. People, this doesn't happen. It just does not get better than this. Oh, wow. you hear her making that little squealing sound of impatience? Look how fat her little belly is. She's just entertaining herself now. This is purely for entertainment. Maybe if I sit up, is it going to be all right? Oh, wow. Isn't that amazing how dexterous they are? Hello, little Charlotte. Your brother's very hungry. Now, we were asked about who's dominant and who isn't, and I think it's quite an interesting question here. Oops. Simply because I think that she's eaten before he has, and that I feel almost like she ate first for some reason. I don't know why she would have. David, do you think the world's slowest photographer is going to get a shot here?
Take a shot, I reckon.
Sorry, Robin, I've missed your question. Can we have it again, please, Becca? Look at this. This is unbelievable. Can we have it again, Bex? Rebecca, Robin's question. Hello, Robin. You say, how's it decided which part of Karula's territory will be given to her daughter? It isn't decided so much as she will just make space wherever there happens to be less pressure, on whichever border there happens to be less pressure. That looked like me climbing out of a tree. Hello. Unsurprisingly, I didn't get one photograph. Look up here, leopard. So, Robin, what will happen is, she's still there, what will happen is that when she gets bigger, Karula's territory will just kind of shrink slightly. Now, on her southern boundary, of course, we know that Shadow's there, Tundi's also there, so it probably won't be from the south, but to the north of her, I think there's much less activity from female leopards. So you'll probably find, I'm going to guess here, that she'll occupy a piece of northern Biffle's Hook. Remember, Karula's not young anymore, and so it is natural for her, there they go, it's natural for her territory to shrink slightly now as she gets a bit older. And so I'm going to guess that if young Charlotte makes it to independence, which we fervently hope that she will, I think you'll find that she will end up in Biffle's Hook on the northern reaches of Karula's territory. And then when Karula dies, passes on to Leopard Heaven, which eventually she must, what you will find, I think, is that that territory will close in. Shadow will come further east, Tundi will come further north, and you'll probably find that this cub, unless she has another female cub after this, will they'll kind of take over that this core area on Juma. But that is many years away. Well, it could be tomorrow if some horrible accident occurs with Karula. But, you know, all things being equal, that's what would happen. Wasn't that amazing? That was just too fantastic. David, I didn't get a photograph of that, if you can believe it.
Oh, James.
Hello, Tasha. While we watch Georgie there gorging himself, Georgie gorging on, it's appalling, on his diker. You say, when will they eat again? Well, I think that this kill will probably last them about 4 days. You know, but that said, if she kills again, you know, if she has the opportunity, if she goes off to mark territory and finds a steenbok lying in her path, well, she'll smash that and put it in a tree and they'll eat again. But they won't become very hungry, I don't think, for the next 3 or 4 days. This is a good meal for them. A nice adult male diker is a good meal for a female leopard and her two little ones. George is definitely having a good meal now, and he didn't eat this morning, as far as I remember. Well, not while Charlotte was in the tree. We're going down to his mum. Let's just watch. It's going to be difficult to see this interaction, but we'll just try and place how the relationship is between mum and son, and then George and Charlotte themselves. Yeah, look at that. Now Charlotte's run to the kill. Look at that, they won't eat together. I find that fascinating. And mum's now going to the kill. So Georgie's on his own. This is just exceptional, people. It's completely exceptional. We've got all three of them on our own, live. So please do enjoy it and remember it. Take your screenshots and load your memory banks with what is truly a remarkable sight. Two little cubs, their special mother, and a glorious winter's afternoon. All right, let's quickly go back to Byron and get an update from him.
Have a look what we have found, everybody. A beautiful female kudu, and there's a young male just behind her. They're both very curious watching us. See a young male, his horns have just started. They're only about the length of his ears. The older he gets, those horns will grow tremendously, and they will spiral up. They form almost like a corkscrew shape. Very, very beautiful turns. And look at those wonderful pink ears. The kudu do enjoy thickets, like we can see right here, very thick areas. But with those very large ears, they can hear very, very well. And they will hear or see if there are any predators around. Have a look at that male's face. Can you see that beautiful white chevron between the eyes? Now, that is there for a reason. So the kudu have evolved in a way that because they enjoy the thickets and the denser bush, that white marking around the eye or the chevron allows light to be reflected to the eyes, and that allows them to see a lot better in the dark shadows or in the thickets. You can see it very, very clearly there. Oh, beautiful antelope. They're very curious. They're just standing watching us. Look at those wonderful white stripes on them. They really are very, very well camouflaged. I mean, look at that male. He blends in very well behind that female. Just the big ears, which you can see. Looks as though that female is chewing the cud. See how she's chewing there. So all antelope in Africa are ruminants, which means they have a specific digestive system. What these antelope do is they feed constantly, and after swallowing the food, they have a four-chambered stomach. And the food is or moves down into the stomachs, It is then mixed with some enzymes and digestive fluids, and it is regurgitated. And what happens then is you get this behavior, and it's known as chewing the cud. Just like cows do and buffalo, they re-chew the food, they break it down even further, and they swallow it again. So it's a very efficient digestive system. They get all the nutrients they possibly can out of the food that they eat. Almost looks like that kudu has had a sip of milk and has got a milk moustache. You see the white markings above the lip. For all of you who have just joined us and who are new viewers, don't forget this is a live safari, so please send us your questions at hashtag safari live on Twitter. or you can email us questions@wildearth.tv. Myself or James will hopefully answer your questions for you. I'm trying to see, there was some Nyala that moved through here too, another species of antelope that look quite similar to the kudu. I think they have moved off into the thicket. We're going to continue though and see what else we can find along the way. Really nice for those two kudu to pose for us so beautifully. They're still standing there. Really, really great to see these different antelope in this area. So James was showing you leopards earlier and the cubs climbing in and out of the trees. And he was saying it looks like the one cub fell out of the tree or got down from the tree like he did the other day. I don't think anything could fall out of a tree like James did. A very, very terrible dismount, if you ask me. But he is still with them. Go back and see what they are up to.
Charlotte is voraciously eating, everybody. Look at her devouring that duiker hungrily. I'm very interested that she and George don't seem to feed together. I think that's quite interesting. I don't know what it means exactly, but I do think it's quite interesting. And, I mean, if she was dominant over him, or if there was some kind of dominance at play, I imagine that she wouldn't have waited for him to leave. And maybe she feels that she needs the security of mum. We've seen him eating on his own twice. He certainly did that last time they had a kill. He spent a lot of time on his own feeding, and she and mum stayed in the tree. And I think that's quite telling. What a joy. Now the wind has switched slightly. I mean, that's not particularly relevant to our game drive, but it does probably mean that the weather will change tomorrow. And I can just feel it blowing from the southeast now. It was blowing northwest earlier. And what that means for George and Charlotte, well, probably absolutely nothing at all. And Karula just gone to sleep there. We can see her, well, not quite, but she's resting up in the shade, just framed beautifully by this apple leaf tree. It's not an apple leaf tree, David, at all. It's a milkberry, not milkwood. Manalkara mochisa, my favorite tree out here. And all is complete, magnificent, wonderful peace. Is that rattling cisticula calling off in the background? Little tin spot battus alarm calling. Couple of starlings flying overhead. No doubt a vulture high in the sky if I look up. No vulture. Now we are going to be joined a little bit later at about 4 o'clock by the teachers' technical conference of Virginia Beach, Virginia. And so we'll be welcoming them. It's not a school drive. In other words, there aren't kids there. They're all teachers having a look at what we do. And I think assessing if they would like to incorporate this as part of their curriculum. I think it'd be quite fun to look at this when you're at school, don't you? Rather than having somebody writing on a blackboard, although I don't suppose they do that anymore. Ah, now Mitch, you make a very good point there. You say, what territory will Shadow give her cubs? And we know, for example, that Shadow's cubs, Shadow's cub is a female. I've called her Zara. And where Zara will go is also moot. Now, to the south of Shadow used to be Kwatile. Kwatile has shaken off this mortal coil through the medium of a snake bite, so she's no longer alive. And I think that territory, as far as I can work out, is probably open. So I'm going to guess that if Zara makes it through the difficult period of life that she's in now, I suspect that's where she'll go. If that makes sense. It was a very astute question, that. Look at them eating away there. And I'm sure there are going to be elephants and buffalo going towards the waterholes today. It's been a hot day for winter. Really, I mean, for us to have this unbelievable pleasure of winter. I mean, I can't believe that this is a midwinter's day. I always found it amazing. I'm just going to have to talk on the radio quickly. So everybody is now starting to get mobile, so we won't be able to have you look. There's a George is going for a little walkabout. He's just straight over the top here. There we go. That's him. And you can see as he started to move, you maybe heard those birds going chip, 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 chip. Now I cannot actually believe this, but Byron has managed to find yet another Varroa eagle owl.
That's right, James. We have found another giant eagle owl. This is beautiful. Just a lucky spot. We actually stopped to have a look at a nest in the tree and then spotted this beautiful Varroa eagle owl, or giant eagle owl, the largest owl we have in this area. Very, very large, about 60 centimeters in height. So very big, and I hope he turns his head again and looks at us. They've got beautiful pink eyelids. And this owl is just hiding in the canopy, trying to get a bit of, get out of the sunlight and rest during the day. And late in the evening, it will fly out and go off and hunt. And if you have a look lower down, just look at those talons that owl has. Very, very sharp. And luckily, VM is able to zoom right in there. Look at that. Those are some serious, serious talons. And they will catch a number of different prey, especially scrub hare, little nocturnal hares which come out. These giant eagle owls will be able to hunt them. What a beautiful, beautiful bird. It's so great to see it out in the open, or during the day at least, because often they hide in even thicker trees than this. This is a nice canopy, it's well sheltered. And later it'll probably move off and go and hunt. Look at those feathers on top of its head. It almost looks like they are ears. If you can see that, if the head turns towards us, you might see it a bit clearer. But you can see those feathers blowing in the wind. Little tufts of feathers above the head look just like ears. This is really great. We've been lucky. This is the fourth giant eagle owl I've seen in the last four days. So that is really, really great. I've got a deep booming sound. Very deep, deep sound. It's my attempt at a giant eagle owl call, but it's not very good. There we go, look at those eyes. Those pink, bright, bright pink eyelids. Occasionally, if they do feel a little disturbed, they'll fly off. This one's quite relaxed, just watching us. This is a nice surprise. It is sitting in a beautiful torchwood tree, or green thorn. Lovely tree. A huge tree, and you can see it's not easily seen. Now that you've or it's been pointed out, you can see it clearly. But if you're just driving past, it may sometimes just look like one of the branches. Look at that stem of the tree. Very distinct. Almost looks like it is twisted. So very easily identifiable, the torchwood. And that owl looks as if it is very happy there and is probably going to stay there for quite some time. Don't want to disturb it, don't want it to fly off. So I think we're going to leave it, but I'm so glad we were able to show it to you. It really is a wonderful bird to see. James is still enjoying the leopard cubs. Let's see what they are up to.
Just eating and eating and eating and eating. That's what's going on here. And we're not going to be here for too much longer, everyone, so let's just enjoy this, simply because the youngsters, at least not the... I really am losing my mind. The other game drives are starting to get mobile, and lots of people want to come in here and enjoy these cubbies like we've had them for 45 minutes here on our own. What a rare joy. But we're going to stay for as long as we can. Our little Charlotte has her meal, her tea. Davy, if I go, shall I go back a bit, or are you happy here? You're happy. So we'll stay here. Lex is coming in. Karula's fast asleep. George has gone off onto the north. He's also fast asleep. He's gone flat cat the other side. Listening to something. I don't know what she's listening to. Her mum's not moving, but her mum's head is up. I'm just going to talk to Lex quickly. Lex, come in. I think I've given him some bum directions, I'm afraid. Anyway, now I'm done. Lex, come in, Lex. Lex, I've obviously confused the issue. I meant the other bank, so the western bank, exactly where you were coming in. I mean, you can get through the drainage over here if you come. So just keep coming, and maybe you can get a view here, and decide from there. Sorry, I'm just helping them get the best view. Lex, of course, found them yesterday. He very cleverly gave his guests some drinks just around Vuyatela Dam. Juma Dam yesterday evening, and Karula popped out to their little babies. Now, let's just give you the lay of the land. You can see Karula's turned around completely. Let me just help Lex quickly here. Heard me mention Lex. Lex, of course, has been guiding in this area for nigh on 35 years, and he and the work that he did with the owners of Londolozi are some of the reasons that we are watching leopards here to this day. They did such a tremendous job of habituating leopards. Is it right? He's just the other side. He's just behind that mound. I think that's a little female feeding. And so, I mean, we had a question this morning about how it is that we're able to watch these leopards like this. And it's just through time. And now we've got created a situation where there are generations of youngsters who have now grown up into adults, have had their own youngsters all over the Sabi sands. to the extent that now if you come to the Sabi Sands and you don't see a leopard, it's almost, it's almost unheard of. It's highly unlikely that where you should you come here, you wouldn't have an amazing sighting of a leopard of some kind. Oh, Byron is on fire with a little slender mongoose.
Oh, we just caught a glimpse of a slender mongoose. Hang on, it's still in that area. Where is it? Moving VM's trying very hard to show you a very shy little mongoose. It's moving through the back there. Hang on, come on. So, a little slender mongoose is a part of the mongoose family. They are very solitary. They're not like other mongoose who live in large family groups. I'm going to try to show you a picture quickly. We've lost him, unfortunately. He ran away from us. But if you have a look, I've got a picture of one. Look at this, a beautiful slender mongoose. And they've got that bright red nose. Here you can clearly see on the tail has got a very dark black strip or tip. And then the mongoose, a very shy little animal, and they'll run through the thickets looking for birds' nests, birds' eggs, anything like that that they'll feed on. And they may also feed on certain insect species. And it was out in the open briefly, and then it ran into a thicket, very, very shy. Oh, so, but we're finding great little stuff this afternoon. It's wonderful. Let's see what else I can find, but while we're doing that, let's cross back to James quickly for an update on those leopard.
Now there's George, everybody. He's just across the way, and he's snoozing, and like his leopards always do, and like he will have to do for the rest of his days, he'll be unable to snooze completely at peace. They always have to be on the lookout. And you never see a leopard sleep in the same way that a lion does. And I'm sure many of you heard me say that before. But lions, you can have sleeping completely dead to the world because they're so confident they know that nothing can come and get them. But these leopards, they sleep a bit, then they look up, and then they put their heads down, they look up again every so often. And that's simply because they cannot afford to take a risk that something might happen upon them. So the slightest scent on the wind, the slightest crunch of a leaf, the slightest kind of hint that there's something amiss, they wake up immediately. And I've walked past lions by mistake and not woken them up. And that's not because I'm tremendously stealthy, it's just because they are so confident that they go completely to sleep in the same way that we as human beings do. There's Charlotte now trying to move the carcass. So far we haven't had to move out, which is fantastic. There are two lions just near the Juma Dam, and so the Zoomy, I don't know who's zooming today, just have a look around there, you can probably see those lions lurking about there somewhere. And Charlotte, just like her brother, using those carnassial teeth. Those molars, those sharp, sharp scissor-like molars. Yes, Gracie, very good question from you. You say, are the baby's teeth like little puppy's teeth? They're exactly the same, Gracie. They come out the same way that little puppy's teeth come out, and then they get big teeth in the same way that your teeth are now coming out, Gracie. Maybe not all of them, but certainly when you get to around about your age, aged eight, that's when your teeth are going to come out. And well, a bit like my teeth did. Well, my teeth didn't, actually. But most... Is that why you were clearing your throat? You see, David was clearing his throat to tell me that the camera was on me. Thank you. I thought it was just because he had consumption. So, Gracie, it's exactly the same as with puppies. Every single mammal in the world has teeth that come out when they're little, and then when they get to sort of around just before adulthood, all of their teeth fall out and they get their proper teeth. Just like you. David?
Yes, sir.
Next time, maybe just a sort of... supposed to... Did you? Okay, I was too involved with my question answering. I don't know if you can hear, but just above us, there's a beautiful bird called a... a beautiful Cape Glossy Starling. Okay. You might just be able to hear it. Betty, hello and thank you for your question. You say, is it possible that the hissing that George is doing at his mother could be interpreted by his sister as aggression and therefore she stays away from the carcass when he's there? Betty, I don't think that's the case, no. I think that's just normal, as leopards will always have to fight for their food, and so they start very early defending it. Go ahead, Orbs. I'm just going to help Aubrey into the sighting. Make your way straight here, Orbs. I'll move out as soon as the fourth station arrives. I'm just trying to think which side would be best. I guess this side. He's not going to see anything from the other side, is he, Dave? Gosh, we have been so lucky. So, Betty, you know, these leopards they're by nature completely solitary. They by nature will have to defend their food. And so it starts at a very early age, and you'll find lion cubs doing exactly the same thing. They actually fight with each other, much more than these two do. And that's because lions, of course, will always fight over their food, whereas leopards will avoid any kind of physical confrontation, despite their unbelievable strength, their profound speed. They will avoid conflict, because they can't afford to get injured. And it's quite something that, you know, I mean, it really is... It says something about their physical prowess. It says something about the difficulties of surviving as a leopard, that they live a very physical life. You know, they do a lot of sleeping, of course, which I'm sure helps them to recover. But, I mean, the risks of injury when you're trying to kill something, even like this duiker, are big. And you know that, professional sportsmen are constantly being injured and have to take time off to recover, and there's no chance for that if you happen to be a leopard or a cheetah. Nothing's going to help you, nothing's going to feed you if you become injured. And so I'm always amazed that there aren't greater injuries. And I think these animals recover amazingly well. And I wonder if the tremendous amount of sleep that they have isn't absolutely crucial to that healing process. Certainly I know that if I have a little muscle injury or something like that, there's no substitute for it, to heal it. There's no substitute for rest. And unfortunately, of course, David, we can't sleep for 20 hours a day, can we?
Unfortunately.
No, we cannot. Such is the life of the human being. We must make a living. Still, to make a living doing what I'm doing right here is absolutely astounding. Not sure there are many better jobs in the world. Perhaps that of an astronaut could be entertaining for a little while. But eventually then you're just hanging around in zero gravity, staring at the Earth, wondering when you can go home. That is a completely ridiculous tangent on which to have gone. I apologize. And just like the adults, you know, these chaps will feed and feed and feed until they're so full that their little stomachs push up against the diaphragm and they'll really struggle to breathe properly. Now, before Aubrey gets in here, what I'm going to do is just sneak a little bit forward so that we can get a view of Karula.
very successful, was it, David? I'm just going to sneak forward. James Dungan, the smells I will describe to you right now. I'm just going to get into a position where Davy can see the queen. David, can you see the queen?
Not yet, James.
She's that large leopard there. Still see the little one? Not really. Oh, there, look, 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 little one's upward one. Look at that. Isn't that fantastic? Now, the smell, I can't smell anything of the carcass. She spotted something coming here. I think it might just be another vehicle. Maybe there's something else. Maybe there's an antelope approaching. So, James, at the moment, it's just a kind of gentle smell of the breeze blowing in from the southeast. It's a cool breeze. There's a little bit of dust hanging in the air, but there's no scent of the carcass for some reason. I'm sure if I was a hyena, I'd be able to smell it. But at the moment, nothing. That's fantastic. Aubrey, come in. Something's going on here. Summit's going on. I wonder if she's going to think about hoisting it now as the afternoon gets a little bit later. You can't smell any of the carcass, can you?
No, I can't.
A much cooler breeze and much fresher breeze than when there's a northwester blowing. Let's just see what happens here. I'll be fascinated to know if she takes it up another tree. She's not going to take it up this one again. Well, not, I don't think, with us sitting right here. We're right under the tree that she took it up earlier. She has a few options there. I might just move back. Let's just see what she does. If she starts feeding, then I won't. If she picks it up, then I'm going to reverse back to give her the chance to put it straight back in this tree if she wants to. We just are, I mean, literally a foot away from the base of the same tree that she was on. Something's got her up. She smelt something on the air. Might just be hungry again, I suppose. But she got up and she looked. See the flicking of the fur? That's to get rid of the flies. I sometimes wish I could flick my skin like that so that I wouldn't have to slap myself continuously. Ooh, very tired. Now, Michelle, very nice question from you. You say, how far from the lions is she? She's not far at all, Michelle, probably about 400 meters, maybe a quarter of a mile. And does she know they're there? I don't know if she knows they're there now. She would have known they were there from the evening, because during the evening, of course, they killed the buffalo. And that would have been a tremendously noisy process. And then they were roaring, those two males were roaring all night long, so she would have known exactly where they were. I don't think she necessarily knows that they're there now. But it's not unheard of for a leopard to go off and try and have a drink. The closest water, she's halfway between the Galago Pan and the pan at the Juma Dam Cam. And so were she to go off there and have a drink, well, she'd figure it out pretty quickly. Now let's see what happens. Let's see. I think she's just feeding. Yeah, she doesn't look like she's going to take it up. You see? Can you hear? Just listen to her ripping the hair off. She'll swallow some of it to line her stomach as roughage, Most of it she'll spit out. Some of it she'll cough out as a hairball later on. You hear that, Dave? I think Charlotte and George are in exactly the same positions that they were. So now it's Mum's turn to feed. I think she's taking, is that the hind quarter? I think she's got the hind quarter there. David is kicking things about back here. He's mistaken the back of the vehicle for a soccer field. There you are, spitting it out. Look at the claws holding it down. Powerful, powerful claws. You wouldn't want those anywhere near you. Just tearing out the hair, patiently eating. And you know, you'll read that leopards take impala as their main source of food. They don't, you know, in this area. The Duiker and Steenbok populations take a nasty hammering from the leopards. They're easy to kill for a leopard, I think. By far the easiest sort of prey. Not very big. They choose sort of hiding as their method of defense. So they don't run away. So if you can find one and you're a leopard, and you're so stealthy like they are, probably relatively easy to kill. Little ones still stay asleep in the same place, so they're not moving at all. Hello, Ellie. Thank you for your question. You want to know about protractable claws. So you know that cats have got what we call protractable claws. Now, you've referred to retractable claws, and you say, is it true that all cats can retract their claws, except for the cheetah? And have I seen her retract her claws? Well, Ellie, if you look at her feet now, her claws are probably not out. Now, what that means is the difference between a retractable claw and a protractable claw is that the protractable claw's default position, the relaxed position of the muscles, is inside the foot, and that's what all cats have. So when they're tense, those muscles, they can push the claws out, and then when they relax those muscles, the claws go back into the foot. Now, that is absolutely true, Ellie, that I think all cats, bar cheetah, have got protractable claws. In other words, the resting position, the claws are inside the sheath. Oh, this is wonderful. Beautiful light, you can see how wonderfully hidden she is. And the cheetah, Ellie, has got a semi-protractable claw, so it can be pushed out slightly, but its resting position is half in, half out. And that, of course, is because when they run, they need sort of running spikes in the same way that a sprinter needs running spikes for grip. That's why their claws are not by default inside. Right, let's nip quickly across to Byron and see what he's found.
I have found a big herd of impala, and they really are beautiful antelope. One of the most, or not one of, but this is in fact the most abundant antelope in this whole area in the Greater Kruger National Park where we are. They do very, very well. They've got a good breeding strategy. So they breed annually. Every year around November, the females give birth. This looks like a large group of females. No horns on the females. Only the big males have got horns. There was a young male over there close to them, but these are predominantly females. They're all feeding, enjoying a bit of grass that they can find around here. So as James was saying, he's read that most books say impala make up the diet, or the predominant part of the diet of leopard. It is the case generally, but they also feed on smaller antelope, like we see with Karula and the dacre that she has. And Steenbok and leopard will also feed on a number of different species of animals. But these impala are really enjoying this area. Have a look to the right a little bit again, those impala that are on the termite mound. And it's quite interesting why they would be feeding up there. Well, the reason I would say is because the vegetation growing on termite mounds is very rich in nutrients. So that soil of the termite mound is very, very fertile. It is made up of termite feces and saliva, and obviously the soil which they excavate. And because of that, it is very, very fertile. So a lot of trees, grasses, and plants that grow on the termite mounds are very rich in nutrients. So a lot of animals will come and feed there. And the interesting thing with impala, and another reason why they do so well, is because they are mixed feeders. So they will feed on grass as well as trees and leaves and so on. So they are browsers, which means they feed on leaves, and they are grazers, which means they feed on grass. So mixed feeders, whereas most antelope species are either one or the other. There are not many species that are both. So that's one of the reasons why they do adapt so well to different conditions. Doesn't matter if it is dry or in the heart of summer. So Cassie Bobassi, I hope I'm saying that correctly, has asked us a question about ruminants and if they also have peristalsis. So I would say they do to an extent, and the reason for that is because they swallow and the food is still passed through into the stomach and the different chambers of the stomach, the four chambers of the stomach, when they regurgitate it, they do still need muscles and peristalsis to get that food back up again and swallow it. And then once it goes back through the stomach, it will go through peristalsis to pass through the rest of the intestine before the dung comes out. So Sherry has asked, do the impala have top teeth? And they do have small teeth. That's a beautiful male over there, possibly the dominant male in this group of impala. They do have smaller top teeth, and it helps them. Oh, that was interesting. Did you see what he did there? That male just lifted his lip. He smelled something on the ground and lifted his lip and bared his teeth for a second. So that is known as phlegmon. What that is the males with most animals will go and taste the urine of the females. What they do is they use their tongues and they taste the urine, put the urine towards the back of the palate. And they've got something known as the Jacobson's organ. It's an organ which allows the animals to tell whether or not the females are in estrus. It's an additional sense organ. So it doesn't matter if it's mating season or not for different animals. For example, the impala only have one mating season, and that is around April, May. And the males will then try and cover as many females as possible. It's not that time of year now. Obviously, we're in the middle of, or the beginning, end of June, beginning of July. So it's not really mating season now, but you may get some males mating with a few females a little bit later on in the year if they were unsuccessful in impregnating them earlier on in the year. So they will still test the urine and see if the females are in estrus or ready to mate. Getting back to the question about the teeth, they do still have small little teeth, but they do lose them quite easily if they die. And the reason for that is predominantly on the top palate. It's a very hard palate which allows them to chew and break down food. So it's not like a set of teeth that we have. Those teeth are mainly used to groom and clean the ticks and fleas out of the animals. So we had another question. So from Derek. Derek has asked, do the antelope lose their horns like antelope, so like deer do? And no, they don't, Derek. What happens is the antelope, their horns grow throughout their lifetime. That is the difference between deer and antelope. Deer will shed their antlers annually and then regrow them, whereas the antelope, their horns grow throughout their lifetime and they do not lose them. If they break a horn, it does not grow back. I'm going to move on from this impala herd. Lovely to see them and chat about them. While I do that, cross over to James for an update on the leopard.
So you here? Right, everybody, hello again. Here we are, Karula, still eating. I'm not sure, are we with the school yet, Rebecca? No. Are we with the school yet, Rebecca? Ah, yes, we're not with the school yet. Okay, good, excellent, no problem. Right, Karula's eating there. Off behind her, Charlotte has gone to lie down. Off to the left, her brother, to whom she does not seem to be speaking, is lying in a little thicket. And so we're just going to sit here for a little while longer, and I think we'll probably have to move out fairly soon so that Aubrey can come and park over here. He's trying to manhandle his his Land Cruiser around. You can maybe just hear him. The Land Cruiser, of course, is like maneuvering a very large oil tanker. Not easy. Unlike these nimble Land Rovers of ours. And I use that, of course, I say they're nimble when they are going. Ah, she's fantastic, isn't she? You can see why the leopard has completely and utterly captured the imagination of just about every safari goer in the world. This animal has been responsible so much for attracting tourists from all over the world to this area, and it's because of this animal, therefore, that this area has maintained itself as a wildlife haven as opposed to, I don't know, farming or perhaps cattle, perhaps even mining. Brilliant stuff. I am astounded we've managed to stay here for so long. It doesn't seem to be that there's a great rush to come down here at all, which is, as far as I'm concerned, absolutely excellent. I suspect George will come down at some stage and see if he can't have another bite to eat, perhaps while his mum's there. So very lucky. And just to, in case you've just joined us, we are sitting here. That's Karula, 12-year-old female. And we're here with the two little cubs. George the male, off to the left of your picture. Charlotte the female, off to the right-hand side of your picture. They are not the real names. They're the names I've given them simply because they are the names, of course, the two youngest members of the British royal family. So I just thought it's rather amusing to call them George and Charlotte. Also, of course, because I know it will provoke a virulent attack from any guide around here who finds out I've named them George and Charlotte is going to be scandalised. So I think it's quite a neat little tease. And the names, of course, are utterly unimportant to the leopards, but they will be eventually named by the guides of this area. They will choose names for them if they get to about a year old. So they're a long way off that. We're up to 5 months come the 2nd of July. And although Karula is showing signs of quite a withered old girl, and I don't mean that in a negative fashion at all. Like I said before, I've got into big trouble before for suggesting that she's, looking a little weathered. She is 12 years old. She's done an exceptional job. I believe these are her eighth cubs, I think. No, they're not. They're more than that. She's raised, I think, eight to adulthood already. No, I'm talking rubbish. These are her eighth. These will be her, I think, her eighth if she gets them to independence. Hello, Kay in Denver. You say, would a leopard ever eat so much that it brought up again? Well, we watched Sandila, her grandson, the other day vomiting, and he vomited up what seemed to be a tapeworm, which was utterly disgusting. We went to then have a look at it, and I don't know, you know, I think it was obviously causing him some discomfort, and that's why he vomited up. I've seen leopards vomit up hair. I've seen them vomit up bones and teeth that they've swallowed by mistake. I've never seen them vomit up meat, so I'm going to say no, Kay. I think that they would stop before they got to the point of being sick. Now remember, their digestive systems are designed to, you know, eat far less regularly than us, and so they can hold a lot more, they can gorge themselves a lot more effectively than we can. Also, the pure carnivores, which these are, have got a very long digestive system, at least a short digestive system. The pure herbivores, like the impala, the ruminants, and the zebra, they've got an extremely long digestive system. But the shorter digestive system of a carnivore is such that, you know, they can push quite a lot through quite quickly. So I think, I think it just goes through them a little bit faster. We, of course, as omnivores, have got a digestive system halfway between a carnivore's and a herbivore's. I don't think vegetarians have a longer digestive system. Do you, David? No, about the same. It's exactly the same as a baboon or a monkey. They've got an omnivorous length of intestine. And that, of course, because the nutrients in meat are extremely, extremely sort of concentrated. Hello, Virginia Beach Technology Conference for Teachers. It's marvelous to have you with us. Welcome. You have joined us at a particularly spectacular time. There's a female leopard. She's eating a dika over there live. Talk to us over the course of the next little while if you'd like to. Ask us questions. Tell us about where you're from and what you hope to get out of this if you like. And yeah, enjoy. I'm not sure how long you're with us, but we're going to be here with this little leopard for a little while. And then we'll probably head on and see if we can't have a look at some lions or hand you over to Byron, who I think is looking for some lions. So you're welcome. And for the rest of you, please remember, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. You're welcome to talk to us at any stage during the course of the afternoon. Two of the animals you can't see from here, a female and a male cub, son and daughter to this magnificent female leopard here. She's 12 years old. They are about 5 months old, and with any luck, we'll get a view of them. I'm not sure how long we're going to be able to be here, because there are other people trying to get into the sighting. So just excuse me 1 second, I just want to get onto the radio. Orbs, do you copy? Looking for Aubrey? Aubrey, do you copy Aubrey? Orbs, are you sure you don't want to come into this position? I'll move out. Okay, copy. All right, everyone, it looks like we'll be able to spend a bit more time here, which is excellent. Now, let's just see. She's looking around. She might call one of those youngsters in here. And they will come down and eat at some stage. Oh, now, Glenda, of course, very good question. You don't know how even close we are. We can't even show you. We're actually very close to her. Dave, does your focus tell you how close we are? So we're probably about, at a guess, 6 meters or so. You can multiply that by 3.25, and you'll get to roughly 20 feet about 20 feet from her. So not far at all, and she's habituated. So she's habituated to vehicles. That does not in any way, shape or form mean that she is tame. She's used to the vehicles, she's used to the sound of them, she's used to the smell of them, and she's used to our presence in them. She's used to the sound of our voices. If we were to walk in here on foot, it would be an entirely different situation. She would be very upset indeed, and she'd either run away or give us a rev. And Phyllis, you want to know how much they can eat in one sitting. They can probably eat, you know, up to 20% of their body weight. So she weighs about 45 kilograms. You multiply that by 2.2, we get a roughly 100 pounds. And 25% of that, 25 or 20% of that, 20 pounds of meat in one sitting, which is pretty impressive. Probably more likely to be about 10 pounds per sitting if she can. But leopards, of course, extremely what we call Catholic diets. They eat just about anything, so she'll eat termites and lizards and frogs and fish if she has to. And obviously to eat 10 pounds of termites, well, that's going to be a challenge. My name is James, by the way. On camera today we've got David. Hello, David. Kim, you want to know how far they have to go to find their food. Their food is all over us. It's all around us. We're surrounded by all sorts of things that leopards like to eat. That's a duiker, which is a small antelope, about 17 kilograms or so for a big female. And so what's that in pounds? Roughly 50 pounds or so. There are lots of them around. They're impala, nyala, bushbuck. Those are the sort of main, and steenbok. Those are the mainstay of the leopard's diet. And they're all over here. Now, she is territorial. And her territory size is largely dependent on the amount of prey that there is within that territory. So you find in areas where there are fewer prey species, like the duiker and the steenbok and the impala, then what happens is that the territory tends to be much larger than they are here. And the area here, her territory is probably, about 150... what am I talking about here? So about 150 hectares, which is about, it's converting here again, probably about 400 acres, maybe 450 acres. So that's a pretty big size. In fact, it's hers is a bit bigger. Hers is probably about, I'd say 800 acres. That's about the size of her territory. Patrick and Renee, a nice question of you, because it must be a little bit odd to be watching us here in the middle of the African wild. We're looking at one of the most famous predators in the world. We're sitting 20 feet from her, and you're saying, what protection do we have? Well, my protection, Patrick and Renee, is to have David on the back of the camera. He is much more obvious than me, so, you know, he's going to be the first to be attacked. So that's my major protection. Patrick and Renee, that's a completely facetious answer, of course. We don't have any protection other than the training we have and the ability to read the animal's behavior. So I'm reading her behavior constantly. She's used to us. I know she's used to us. And although I know she's used to us, especially with animals like elephants, we watch their behavior all the time. Animals out here will warn you if they're uncomfortable, like she would growl. And if she growled, then we would move away. And if an elephant, for example, shakes its head at you, then you probably move away and give it a bit of space. And that's basically how we do it. On foot, people often carry weapons and very seldom have to use them. But you can do that. But there are a lot of people who walk around in the bush there that don't carry weapons at all. And it's because animals out here, Patrick and Renee, are inherently afraid of human beings. They see us as the apex predator. And that means that they are constantly, they're nervous of us. So if you don't threaten them, they will normally leave you completely alone. But if you threaten an animal like this, well, then you will know all about it for a short time. Right, I can't believe our luck today, everybody. Let's go and have a look at some lions with me old pal Byron Sorrell.
Thank you, James. Yes, we have been very, very lucky this afternoon. Beautiful sighting of those leopard. Welcome to the Virginia Beach Technology Conference for Teachers. Great to have you with us. Hope you're enjoying the show so far. And look what we have for you this afternoon. We've got these two beautiful male lions. These two males were calling a lot last night, very close to the camp. And they stole a young buffalo kill from some lionesses that killed the buffalo last night. And these two males finished it. You can see those two bellies are very, very full. And they have been resting here for most of the day. They moved into the shade a little bit. It's nice to see them out in the open. It is a cool afternoon, so they're not right in a thicket. They are happy to lie out with a little bit of afternoon sunlight on them. It is fantastic to see them here. This is a photographer's dream now with this afternoon sunlight, this golden hour and a half. Great natural light for photography. My friend behind me on camera, VM, this afternoon, is focusing wonderfully on those large paws. Tara would like to know, how much time do we spend doing this? So, Tara, with Safari Live, we are live every day in the morning for 3 hours, from 6:30 to 9:30 at the moment, and in the afternoon, we are live from 3 to 6 in the afternoon. So 6 hours a day going on safari and showcasing this beautiful area to all our viewers from all over the world. If you go on safari to a lot of different lodges all over Southern Africa, it's pretty much the same time frame. You can occasionally spend a bit longer or shorter on game drives. It all depends on how the guests are feeling and what you're seeing out there. But it's not unusual to take a 3.5 or 4 hour game drive at times. Those beautiful manes, really golden coloration. So a big goodbye to the Virginia Beach Technology Conference for the Teachers. It was wonderful having you with us for a very short time, but I hope you've enjoyed it. And hopefully you tune in to us sometime soon again, and we'll show you some more of our wildlife. Thank you very much for joining. I hope the rest of you are still with us. We are still going to sit here for quite some time with these lions. I'm hoping that as it cools down, we get a little bit of activity from them. Perhaps we are lucky and they get up and walk towards the water hole, which is not too far from here, and they have a drink of water. And if we really are fortunate, which we have been today, we may get them calling. And the lovely lion roar is amazing to hear in the bush. So Lisa is asking, is it common to see two male lions together? So Lisa, I wouldn't say it's common, but it's not unusual. So Lisa, what happens is a lot of the, hang on, James has got something quickly before I answer that. Cross over to James.
Check this out, everybody. Look, she's going up the same tree, I hope. This is amazing. We have had an afternoon second to none here. This is unbelievable. So there she is, thinking about which tree to take that into. Where's she going to go? just frozen there. I'm not sure if one of the cubs is maybe coming this way, but I'm hoping she's going to take it up the very same tree she was in. Isn't that fantastic? And nobody else seems to be coming here. We've just, I keep thinking we're going to have to move out, but we don't. You can see the dika is not alive. Can you see that, David? Yes. You note that from the fact that its eyes are a little lifeless. Otherwise, it would be difficult to tell. Now, I'm not sure what she's considering or why she's not moving, but let's just be very quiet and move. It's as I moved away from the tree that she seemed to decide that it was a good idea to take it back up there. And I think maybe the fact that it's the night is starting to, not quite fall. Here we go. Look at this. This is very exciting. She seems to be almost willing me to get a decent photograph before she goes up. There we go. Look at that. Isn't that unbelievable? That is just the best. Hey? That's fantastic. Right, we are now going to go round to the other side. And I think we'll get a great view of her the other way. That's fantastic. I'm just going to move out the way, everybody, for Andrew. Let's go across to Byron. He's with the lions. I think that's what was the instruction, was it?
So happy you got to see the leopard hoisting that kill. It's incredible to see them do it. Just shows you the strength and power that those leopards have. Lisa, just getting back to your question, you were asking, is it common to see two males together? So what happens is, I wouldn't say it's common, but it's not unusual. In this part of South Africa, and in most areas, you find coalitions of males forming. So this will often be brothers that were born into the same pride, not necessarily the same mother, could just be somewhat related, but are usually from the same pride. And as those lions grow up together, they form a coalition. The reason for that is they can be more successful if they work together. They can have larger territories. They can keep out potential threats or other lions. And that then can ensure that they have the ability to mate with different females from different prides. You can also get a single male that is in a pride and he is the dominant male that will stay with those females the entire time, but he will have a hard time protecting them from two males like this. Obviously, two big males coming in and challenging will chase him off very easily. I've seen coalitions of four and sometimes five males staying together. You can also get a case or scenario where you have a different male that is close by and joins a coalition and they accept him. It doesn't happen often, but it can happen. Generally, though, they are from the same pride and they will stick together. While they patrol those territories, they may split up at some point, and occasionally they'll spend a few days apart, but they will always know where the other brother or brothers are, and they will be able to meet up. They will be able to meet up very frequently, especially if the females have a kill, like they did this morning. Generally, the females do most of the hunting, but the males will hunt for themselves too if they really want to, or if they have to. But it's easier to come through, chase females off a kill, and feed on what the females have got, and then move on afterwards. If it's a big kill, they will feed for a while, and then eventually when they're full, they will allow the females to feed too. They are very, very relaxed at the moment. So Carolyn Hayes has asked us a question. And Carolyn would like to know, is it true that the male lions are able to smell which cubs belong to them and which don't. Yes, Carolyn, it is true. These lions have an incredible sense of smell. Usually what happens, now, when I say they are able to, I think there's a bit of a story attached to that. And the reason with that is the lions, I think, will recognize the scent of the female and the cubs, and they will recognize that they've mated with that female. So they then recognize that those cubs are potentially theirs. I don't think it is a case that they can smell the genetics of the cub and recognize their specific gene that they have passed on to those cubs. That, I think, is impossible. But they are able to pick up on the scent of the females that they have mated with, and that will allow them to tell that those are their cubs. If they pick up on the scent or that they don't recognize potentially different males that have given birth or mated with those females and they gave birth to those cubs, then these males would most likely kill them because that's potential future competition. We're going to sit with these males a little bit longer. While we do that, head back to James for an update on Karula.
She's in the tree. We've come around to the other side, everyone. I don't know where the little ones are, though. We saw not hide nor hair of them as we drove carefully around here. You can see where she's looking and the golden light of the sun just catching her magnificent face. We are so lucky here. So lucky. I'm hoping she's not going to jump out just yet. I'm also hoping she's going to poke her face out from where she's sitting now. Isn't that lovely? Ah, wow. We've had an amazing day here. The Queen and her offspring have done an incredible job for us. Mitch, you want to know if Karula is the most successful and prolific mother in the area thus far? She certainly comes close. There are a few around, though. There are a couple down at Londolozi who've done as well as she has. I'm sure there are a couple at Mala Mala that have done as well as she has, but she has done well. Certainly of the leopards in this area, she is the oldest, and I think by default, therefore, she's done the best. Look at the golden light catching her. She could not have set this up more perfectly if she tried. Thank you, Mrs. Karula. Your Majesty. I'm just looking, keeping a beady eye out for the little ones. A little bit of movement. Carolyn, nice one from you. You want to know why she's named Queen Karula. She was by default named the Queen, I guess, because she's the most often seen leopard. She is so obviously regal. And Karula means peaceful in Shitonga or Shangan, and that's why she's called Karula, because she's very peaceful and she seems to be very relaxed most of the time. I'm just listening to a chinspot batis calling behind us and wondering if the batis hasn't spotted a baby leopard, and maybe that's why they're alarm calling. I think that's exactly the case. Davy, I'm going to take a chance and move us just slowly in there so that we might get a view of her face in the setting sun. Don't move, my dear. Don't move. Stay there. Say when you've got a shot. That's fine. There we go. Isn't that fantastic? What an afternoon this has been. I don't know where she's looking. Yeah, maybe she's going to come out. Shays, you say, why does she not seem concerned about where her cubs are now? Should she not be concerned? She's She is. I mean, she's looking around. She'll know where they are. She's calling. Now she's calling. Watch. Just watch her mouth. She'll go. She'll know exactly where they are. And she is concerned all the time. But they're not that vulnerable because they're now 5 months old. They can climb trees very well indeed. Let's see what she does now. Not the most elegant descenders. Well, she is. Isn't that wonderful? I think she's looking for them now. I would imagine, you know, they've been around here all day long. I would imagine she knows where they are. I'm going to take my binoculars out. See if I can't spot them. I can't see them anywhere. And I was surprised that we didn't see them as we came through the drainage there. But, you know what, this morning when we came through here, the cab was a long way from the kill, and the kill was in the tree that it's in now. And the other one was about 200 meters away. Shall you say, will the cubs climb the tree for safety with her later? They might not. If they sense danger, they'll most certainly go up the tree. Whether they will sense danger or not, you know, whether or not a hyena comes through here or something like that, I'm not sure. I can see that, yeah. Right, wondering if we shouldn't just let the situation lie. We'll try for one more view, everyone, but we're not going to be here once the sun goes down. We don't want to be in a situation where the cubs are, well, we're not going to view them after dark, and we're certainly not going to put a light anywhere near them. And I'm reticent to go driving back through the drainage line there. Let's just go back a little bit and have a see. I think while we decide what to do here, everybody, let's go back across to Byron and find out about those lions, and I'll make a decision on whether we'll stay here or not.
We've just changed our position slightly just to have a look at the other male's face. Look at that. Very, very big male too. I think, and we were having a look now, it looks like he got the lion's share of the meal this morning, and definitely looks like he ate more of the kill than the other male did. Very, very full belly. I can't believe how lucky James has been. To show you those, that female leopard and her cubs all afternoon. It's wonderful, really, really great sighting. And we've got lions around. There's so much happening at the moment. What we're going to do, though, is we're going to leave these lions for a short while. I'd like to just drive around, see if there's anything else on the clearings not far from here. And then we are going to return a little bit later, maybe in the next 20 minutes or so, and see if we get any movement from these lions. As I said, hopefully they head over to the waterhole, which is not too far in that direction, and then we'll come back and see what they are up to. So Rob from New Jersey has asked, do the lions usually like to sleep undercover, or do they sleep out in the open like this? So Rob, generally it depends on the time of year, and I'll tell you why. In summer it's obviously very, very hot. So the lions prefer lying in the shade, so they will go into thickets and really lie up or down into drainage lines. They'll prefer lying there. It's much cooler in the soft sand or under the shade of a tree. But this afternoon it's been a very cool afternoon. The temperature has dropped quite a bit. They did move into the shade earlier today, but I think they moved out a little bit as the temperature dropped. It's not too hot, and it's nice to have a bit of that afternoon sun on them. So that is why those lions are out in the open. And they don't mind lying out in the open. Nothing will bother them. Those are two big dominant males, so there's no reason for them to hide away from anything. So it all depends on the time of year, Rob. Let's see what we can find up on the clearings up ahead. If there is anything out here. So Monique from London has asked us, is there, or do I have any idea where that lioness is? I don't, Monique. I've tried to look around there. I can't find her. She may have just moved off. And I'm guessing she may have moved in the direction of where the other two lionesses were. We found them later this morning. They were quite far from here, right up on the Biffleshook boundary road, between Biffleshook and us. And I think potentially what happened is these males chased all those lionesses off the kill. And those two ran away and that one lioness stayed. But I think she may have got up and tried to meet up with those other lionesses. I drove past there earlier this afternoon, couldn't see them. They had moved off too, so I'm guessing they crossed north out of Vuyatela. Don't know, but there's nothing left of that kill, Monique. That they've eaten everything. That whole carcass is finished. Like I said, it was a young buffalo calf, so there wasn't a lot of meat, but it was enough to feed 3, 4, maybe the 5 lions all got to feed on it. I'm not too sure how much the lionesses got to eat on it. When we got them this morning, it was just the males feeding. So I'm on the quarantine clearings at the moment, just having a look if we have some general game up here, maybe some giraffe walking around, buffalo, elephant. We haven't seen elephant this afternoon. We saw a lot of elephant this morning. It just happens, and often happens like an elephant will come through and they drink at the waterhole and then they move off and carry on again. Can cover huge distances. Trying to see some tracks around here. Oh dear. Please don't tell James about that. He will mock me for days. There's a few buffalo tracks, and I think that herd of buffalo must have moved through this area last night, and those are the buffalo that the lions chased and managed to get that calf from. Not too much activity out in the clearings. I'm going to hang around this area a little bit longer, just keep looking, see if we can't find anything. But I'd like to hang around with these lions because I'm sure it's going to be worth it. Just got a feeling that as the temperature starts dropping, they are full at the moment, but still in the cooler conditions, they do get up and move around quite a bit. And we might just be lucky and get them moving around. So I don't want to go too far. Keep scanning. Oh dear, no. There's one impala up on the clearing. Not too much else out here. I think those lions managed to chase everything off or from this area last night. Like I say, we're going to stick in this area for a little bit. Just head back to those lines a little bit later. I'm going to do one more loop a little bit further down. See if we can't bump into anything else. Still have lovely afternoon light. shining on these beautiful marula trees. You see these large trees growing out in the clearings. This is a beautiful marula tree. I always think they're perfect trees for leopard. They've got large branches and they span out, but usually quite horizontal, so it's lovely for a leopard to go and lie up on in them. But you don't often see it. You think it happens a lot, but it doesn't. It really doesn't. You're going to be quite lucky to be able to see a leopard up in a marula tree like that, especially the larger ones. So Colin Richards has just joined us and is a new viewer. And you're asking, is this live? 100% live, Colin. Whatever we see, you see. Very, very much live. So there's no cuts or take backs or anything. And that's why while we're driving, we're trying to find the beautiful birds just flying off. See if they sit for us. I'd like to show you them. There they go. These are called green wood hoopoes. Let's see if we can. There they go. Listen to. Oh, look at that beautiful red beak. Wonderful. So, green wood hoopoes. They used to be known as red-billed wood hoopoes, but somebody thought it was necessary to change the name. And you can actually see that beautiful iridescence now as the light is hitting the feathers. You can see they do have a greenish tinge to them. And that is why they are now known as the green wood hoopoe. I still think red-billed wood hoopoe is a little bit more fitting. So Colin, as I was saying, while we are driving, what we see is what you see back home, and it is completely live. I don't see him picking for insects in the bark. A lot of spiders, little bugs, beetles, anything in the bark that they might be able to feed on, worms. So John in Florida has asked me, what is the rarest bird that I've ever seen on safari? Rarest bird. So, well, you know, we have the southern ground hornbills in this area. I'll try to get a picture for you quickly. Let me see if I can find one to show you what they look like. They are very endangered. So I suppose you could say they are rare and you don't see them often. I've seen quite a few of them around, which has been great. Let me just find it. There we go. Let me get VM just to show you this bird quickly. So that is what the southern ground hornbill looks like. As I said, they are very endangered, so I have seen them. They are, I wouldn't say rare, because you do see them in parts of Kruger if you are lucky, but they are endangered. But I'd say one of the rarest birds, and let me just find it quickly. The, what's the name again? spotted creeper. Spotted creeper. Now let me show you. It is a, well, I think a very rare bird, because they are very difficult to find. And they only occur in certain parts of Africa. And they mainly occur up in Zimbabwe. So let me show you over here. That is the spotted creeper. And that is probably the rarest bird that I've ever seen. I've been fortunate enough to go into an area in Zimbabwe where they are seen. And we specifically went looking for this bird. And we found it. They jump around on trees looking for insects. Usually little worms and that they feed on. Larvae, spiders. And they are not easy to see, but I managed to see one of those. So I'd say that is probably the rarest bird that I've seen. Let us continue. We are passing some other guests at the moment on safari. Good afternoon, everyone. Hello, how are you? Good, good. Enjoy. Cheers. See, so while we out on safari, have a lot of other people on safari too. And James Richard has asked us, what is the preferred nest site for a wood hoopoe? Now, generally they do nest in the stems of trees, James. They'll find little holes that they will go into a nest in there. So something like a marula tree would provide probably a lovely area or a lovely hole for a nesting bird like the wood hoopoe. It will go into those holes. Some areas you might find people put up in parts of South Africa and that they put up bird boxes. And usually these bird boxes have little holes and they'll get birds going in and nesting there. Hang on a second, I just saw something. Look at this beautiful sunset behind us through the trees. Just a wonderful color. It's still quite bright, but just through the trees there, it's starting to drop. It's very, very bright still, but within a few minutes, we're going to have a beautiful sunset. I think let's head back to those lions quickly and see if they haven't decided to move. So, while I'm heading back to the lions, I hear James is now trying to follow up on Wild Dog, and I'm not sure, I think he has got a report. Cross over to him quickly, see what he's got up to, and then you can get back to me.
There they are. Everybody, we've come to the place where the dogs are, and the dogs are here, somewhere, just near here. I'm going to just try and get a view. I don't know if they're mobile or not. I thought I saw them. I'll just get past this fellow. There we go. There's a dog. Two dogs. And a vehicle. Don't worry, we will... We can't go where he's going. So we're going to have to wait for him to go in there. And then we will have a view. So they are north of our boundary that we're allowed to go to. Let me just go forward. So that's Wild Dogs, everybody. Endangered species. Second most endangered carnivore in all of Africa. And sitting... Oh, sorry, my audio is muffled because it's in my jacket. And that is because I'm an idiot. There we go. Just go a little bit forward. We might get a nice view here. Yes, we will. We'll get a nice view here, Davey. You tell me when, right? Fantastic. Now, I know for some people who've perhaps never seen these before, many have never even heard of them, these are the wolves of Africa. They're called painted wolves. That's what their Latin name means. They're not related to domestic dogs. And they're not related to wolves. Well, they are, of course, but they're not very closely related. And they're one of the most endangered animals in all of Africa. There are probably fewer than 2,500 of them left. They're hugely prone to diseases brought in by domestic animals. But here they are, and for me, my favorite carnivore out here. Not doing a great deal at the moment, and this is unusual for wild dogs. They normally move around a huge amount at this time of the day. And I think it's going to be worth just sitting here for a little while to see if they don't get up and move towards us, towards the south. Biffleshook Dam is not far from here, and Biffleshook Dam would be a good place for them to go hunting. I can only see two of them, you know. Dave, can you see any others?
Just the one, James.
Just the one. Good grief, David. You might have to have your eyes tested fairly soon. The second one, David, in the left-hand side of your frame there, behind the trees. That's it.
Now, a pack of two is very unusual, unless it's a dispersal pack. A dispersal pack would be a pack of males or females, yearlings, that have left their natal pack, so the pack into which they were born, and they'll go and try and set up another pack. There we go, one's up. Skinny little legs. Cat in Tampa, a nice one, of course, given the relationship we know that domestic dogs and domestic cats have. And you say, well, wild dogs chased cats, cubs. Would those cubs be in danger? No, not from these dogs, I don't think. If they came across them, yes, then they'd probably kill them. All the predators will kill each other's offspring if they can to reduce competition, we think, and reduce threat. But male leopards, believe it or not, are renowned for taking wild dog puppies. So they do not have a strong relationship. And that wild dog probably weighs about 25 kilograms. Which is about half the weight of Karula, maybe a little bit more. But Karula is a lot more solid and a lot heavier, built for explosive speed. Whereas that dog is built for coursing, for running big distances. See, they're starting to get moving now. Might lie down a bit and just... There's another one there. There might be another one there. I can't see. No, I can't see another one. Just look how unbelievably perfectly camouflaged they are in this winter vegetation. Now, I'm just going to sneak forward so maybe you've got a better view of the other one. There. How's that, Dave? This, of course, is the time of the year when they give birth. And they are unusual in that they give birth not during the rainy months when there are lots of little babies around. They give birth when there are no little babies around in terms of herbivores. And they do that for precisely the reason that you open, which you're hunting. They're coursing predators, they're not ambush predators like. Roger, to see. Some of the day. I'm not sure they're not doing it now unless they had a really. But after they'll hunt during the particular time. The evening. Joe, you really think about Karula? Long way, 3 miles. I think we might. Go and go looking for them. Think that them here. They had a meal earlier today, then they'll probably just lie there. We have an amazing view of the sunset there that David is showing you. Rather splendid. Isn't that lovely? And you can see the amount of dust there is in the air. It's been quite a day. I'm going to try this.
What happens?
I think it's going to be better than. Right, sorry about that everybody, not sure what happened there, but there you can see the beautiful African sunset. It is coloured red like that by the southeasterly breeze that is blowing through here, blowing up the dust. Perhaps there might even be a fire in one of the forests down towards the south, and those will be sort of plantation forests for paper trees, excuse me, and planking trees. And that's why it's so very red and beautiful. Can you get by there, Andrew?
Yeah, I will.
Okay. Enjoy. Bye-bye. That's just saying goodbye to Andrew. He's been enjoying the dogs. He was enjoying Karula with us. Let me just stick my binoculars in there again and see if I can't see any more, because I find it amazing that there are only two of them there. Two invisible hounds. Now, Raisa, you say, isn't this the pack of only three dogs? It could well be, Raisa. Our little Investec pack, I think, has been reduced to three. Well, and we actually had another pack of three. Remember that dispersal pack that we had on Cheetah Plains? So it could well be. And I haven't seen a pack of two in this area. And it could easily be that pack of three. And we might just be missing one of them behind one of those logs. Let me roll back a bit. See one there. And we'll just roll. Oh, one of them's. Another one's up. Just behind, obviously. Let me go a little bit forward. I think it's highly unlikely that they're going to stay still the whole day or the whole night. I mean, I think it's more than likely that they'll get up and move. Just not yet, and you can see, maybe you can hear the wind now picking up, and especially as the sun's just dipped below the horizon, wind blowing through the trees here. You can hear the rustling of the leaves. They're going to start falling down, of course. Oh, marvelous. Byron has got some elephants. Let's go and have a look.
Just had a moth on my jacket, but yes, we do have some elephant. Have a look just off to the side. Looks like a herd that is in this thicket, and I can see one or two babies in the background. But this young one is feeding on the branches and the bark of those trees. Very interesting to see. Look, now it's stripping some leaves. Feeding on that, but there are a few elephant through here, and I'm hoping they are going to head out into the open pretty soon. And it looks like they are. Give me a second, I'm just going to move forward. It looks like a big adult coming through. Let me see if I can show you where she is. Ah, look at this, and the baby. Oh, wonderful. We have been very fortunate today. We've seen so much. Let's see what they do. Those young elephants are so cute. This was just while we were on our way back towards the lions. I don't think they have moved yet. Had a brief look at them as we passed, but we heard the elephant and came to have a look. They've been feeding in this thicket. It would be wonderful if this female came right up to us. Hilna has asked us a question about the elephant and their aging. And Hilna would like to know, do these elephants get aged in a similar way that dogs do? Does one dog year equal 7 human years? And no, I don't think so, Hilna, not at all. You know, obviously the youngsters mature a lot quicker than we do, but I don't think they get aged like that. Elephants have a lifespan of about 50 to 60 years. Exactly, they would probably be very old then. I don't think so. Oh, look at that baby. Following the mother. Isn't that fantastic? Lovely. Great to see some elephant. Just before this, all the sun has gone down, so we're losing a bit of light already. But we caught them just in time. So I heard of elephant this afternoon too. We've seen so much. We're going to head on a little bit and see what those males are up to. Maybe we're lucky and they've got their heads up showing signs that they might start moving. Temperature's dropped quite a bit now, so it is really cool. Looks like those males are still lying down. They have not moved. Very comfortable, they're full, they've eaten a lot, they've probably had some water. Actually, we did see the one drinking earlier today. So they've had water and food and they're very happy, but I'm sure they may try and drink a little bit later again. Let's just position ourselves here. There we go. John has asked, do elephant sleep standing up? So John, I have seen elephant, well, I say sleeping, but dozing off or resting while standing up. Again, none of these animals, to my knowledge, go into a state of sleep like we do. Yes, even though these lions look as if they are fast asleep, they are definitely still completely aware of what's going on around them. Same with elephant. Elephant will go and they'll go into a state of rest or what looks like sleep. They'll close their eyes and they do nod off a little bit, but they're still completely aware of what's going on around them. They do that standing up, but the elephant will also do it lying down. They do lie down. We saw a young calf a few days back go and lie down close to its mother and it was resting. But I've seen big elephant bulls, I've seen herds of elephant go into an area and lie down and rest for a while. Rest for 20 minutes, half an hour, and then get up and start moving again. So they do sleep standing up and lying down, but again, it's not a state of sleep that we are used to. It's not completely out. They are still very aware of what's going on around them. All the animals have to be. Otherwise, you know, out here, everything is potential prey for some of the predators. Even large elephant, lions will go for them, and also the lions still need to be careful that they don't get ambushed by perhaps other lions coming into their territory. So everything needs to be aware and alert. The other thing is, if lions are sleeping and potential food walks past or prey, if they're not alert and aware, they'll miss it. So they do still keep an ear out for any animals moving around. I've seen lions sleeping like this in an impala accidentally run into a pride and run into the group. And before I knew it, the males were actually up before the females. They grabbed the impala, pulled it down, and the whole pride got to feed on it. The males took most of it, though, and it happened very quickly. Within 20 minutes, the entire impala had been eaten. But it just shows how quick and alert they are if they have to be. Getting back to James, I'm very, very jealous that he got to see the wild dogs. I looked for them this morning, I looked for them this afternoon, and we had no luck. I think they may have crossed the boundary and they moved a little bit further back, maybe went towards Biffle's Hook Waterhole to drink again this afternoon. I'm not too sure, but James was lucky enough to find them and show them to you. I'm happy about that. It's always great to see wild dog. And speaking of which, why don't we go back to him and see what they're up to.
Well, that's very, very gracious of Byron indeed to say that he's happy that we're sitting here with these wild dogs. I'm very happy we're sitting here with these wild dogs. David, are you happy we're sitting here with the wild dogs? Ecstatic. Good news. Now, they've done absolutely nothing since you left us. And I was just reading about them, or I was reading about a number of canids around here. And although they are called Lycaon pictus, which of course is a different genus from wolves and domestic dogs and some foxes and jackals, there are some scholars who will call them canis. In other words, they're probably more closely related to jackals and domestic dogs and wolves than we think they are. I don't think that interbreeding is possible. As far as I'm aware, it is not. But they can sometimes be found in association with jackals. So they are a social species, and if they happen to find themselves on their own, it's not entirely unlikely that they would go off and spend a bit of time with some jackals. And the jackals, of course, don't mind that because, well, wild dog provides regular meals. So we won't sit here for too much longer. We'll just be here. You know, we can sit with them till it's dark, I guess. But I wonder, I think they probably had a fantastic meal this morning, and that's probably why they are not doing anything as we speak. They're probably just lying there. With any luck, those lions are going to wake up and start roaring. And of course, hearing lions roar would be wonderful. Now, Julie in New York, at least in, not New York, in Old York, there in the North Country, you want to know, I think this is a very good question, because they're so endangered, and because, we know these packs, would it not be viable to dart them in order to give them some kind of inoculation against canine distemper and perhaps rabies as well? Julie, I don't know, you know, I don't know what the mechanism behind that is. I don't know if you could dart them with an antidote or dart them with an inoculation. I suppose you might be able to, I don't know, certainly for rabies, you know, you can give a domestic dog a shot. Maybe it would be worth giving them a shot. I think if they're ever darted and caught or collared, I think they are given rabies shots. But whether you could administer that through a dart, I don't know. And B, I don't know what the status of treating canine distemper is. I don't know if you can inoculate against it or not. So if anyone can tell us, that would be great. But yeah, you know, I mean, they're probably only 300 or 350 or so in the Kruger National Park. And therefore, you would imagine it would be viable to give them some kind of inoculation, unlike the lions and the buffalo, for example, which have bovine tuberculosis. It would be almost completely impossible to try and inoculate them. Because there's so many of them, it would be totally impossible to find them all. So I think we will just sit here for another 5 or 10 minutes, and then we'll press on and see what else we can see as the night falls. But I think Byron would be well advised to hang around those lions and see if they don't get up and start doing something exciting. I'd love to know from you, and I haven't asked this for some time, I'd love to know from you in one word what that scene that you're looking at makes you think about. Because I've been struck by how differently this landscape makes me feel at this time of the year. And so if you wouldn't mind, if it's not too much to ask, won't you send through one word for how that landscape with the dog in it, and of course the colours around there, the wind, the atmosphere, you know, the sun's just set, the temperature's dropping, how does it make you feel in one word? Hashtag Safari Life, questions at wildebeests.tv. I'd be fascinated to know, and then I'll tell you how it makes me feel. David, you are not excluded from this. You will come up with a word as well, please. Yes. Because I tell you, I feel so very different when the land is like this. I feel two things, actually. I'm not going to tell you and you till you've told me. So let's just enjoy these doggies for a little while. They did sit up briefly while you were away there with the elephants. But at the moment, you can see fast asleep. And just so perfectly, perfectly coloured there. That copper colour behind, a little bit of green, yellow, lots of red, lots of different shades of oranges and coppers and browns, and you can see the grass moving there as the temperature drops. And I'm sure you can hear the last of the dongos going righty, the lions are starting to get up. Please send through your word, and while you're doing that, enjoy the enormous Birmingham boys.
That's right, James. These lions are starting to wake up. I've had two yawns from this male already, and yawning is usually a good sign. It's never a guarantee, but yawning, that means they're trying to get oxygen into their body, trying to wake up, and potentially may stand up and move around. They could also just stand up and change position and lie down again. But their heads are up, and that's a good sign. They are waking up. The other male too. You can hear things moving through the thicket behind us. I think it's the elephant that was breaking branches, a few more branches behind. Look at that. Beautiful. That is great. That's why patience always pays off in the bush. Just need to sit and wait. Enjoy everything else that's going on around. A lot of bird life. We saw the elephant walk past. And now the lions are waking up, which is fantastic and which is what we wanted. Beautiful face. Wow, so there's another big yawn. Look at that. We have been very, very fortunate this afternoon. Wait, another yawn. That's good. I'm sure he's going to stand up shortly. Come on, let's see. Let's see if I'm right. I am guessing that that male is going to stand up very, very soon. As I was saying, we've had such a lucky afternoon. Leopard with two cubs. You had elephant, you had wild dog, and lions. There's another yawn. Ooh. Come on, don't let me down. Again, there's general behavior that I've seen in the past that leads up to certain behavior from the animals, but it's not always a guarantee. We are sitting very close to the dam cam at the moment. It's very close to Vuyatela Dam. Oh. Look at those teeth. Another big yawn from that male at the back too. They definitely are yawning. As I'm saying, you know, there's certain behavior that we've seen in the past that leads up to something happening, like a yawning does tend to lead to them standing up, waking up, moving around, but it's never a guarantee. They could yawn and then just flop over and go back to sleep. So I'm taking a chance by saying I think they're going to get up soon, but they are showing signs of waking up, movement, cleaning. These are all good signs showing us that they potentially will stand up. Another big yawn. Incredible teeth on these males. This is what we wanted, everyone. We wanted to see these lions with their heads up, waking up. If we're lucky, we may get a roar later. A territorial roar, warning other lions that this is their territory, that they should stay away. Just hear the branches being broken in the distance. That's what those lions are watching. The elephant breaking some branches and feeding in the distance, probably about 100 meters or so away from here. Not too sure if they can see them. Looks like there are some trees blocking it. Oh, there we go. See? As I said, that he flopped over. So Francie has asked, are these the lions that we possibly heard last night on the dam cam? Yes, Francie, these are the lions. I do think the females also called last night. I was listening early this morning and last night, and I heard lionesses calling. The lioness roar is a little bit shorter and not as deep as a male's. It's very difficult to tell the difference, though, and I'm speculating a little bit. But I do think those females were calling too, and later on I heard the males calling, and they were definitely longer roars than the ones that we heard earlier. But these are definitely the lions that you heard calling last night and for us early this morning. Just cleaning her paws. Just got a question about the coalitions and if the coalitions would challenge each other. Yes, definitely. The coalitions do challenge each other. And that is why it's important for these coalitions to stick together. The larger the coalition, so if you have males of three or four males, coalitions of three or four males together, they will be far more successful than coalitions of just one or just two, for example, or if a male is by himself. But there's constantly territorial disputes going on between lions. So if you have a very successful coalition, large, strong, powerful males, they will be able to keep out any other potential threats or potential challenges for their territory and for their females. These coalitions will mate with females from different prides, not just one pride. Just remember, in nature, success is purely a case of having a large territory and having offspring. If they have offspring, they are considered successful. So that's what these males strive to do, and that's why they stick together. Sounded like some hyena calling very far away, very faint call. Stephanie has asked us a question about lions' eyes and whether or not they dilate like a domestic cat if they see prey. They definitely dilate. The pupils do increase in size and decrease in size, but that's purely based on the light. I'm not too sure if it's a case of when they see prey. It all depends on the situation, because they will see prey during the day and at night. So I think it's more a case of how much light is around so that they can see their prey a lot better. You see that white underneath that male lion's eye. Another big yawn. So that the white line under the eye, the theory is that that allows more light to be reflected to the eyes of these predators, these nocturnal predators, so that they can see a lot better at night. Their eyesight is far better than ours. And it's measured, I think the scientists have measured it because of the number of rods and cones in the eye itself compared to ours. So it is very, very different. And they believe that they see in a more neutral color. So generally a black and white shade as opposed to the color spectrum that we have. Again, it's studies that have been done on the amount of rods and cones in their eyes, and they, I think, are able to tell more or less what they see. But I think it is very difficult, but nowadays, technology, they're able to test these theories very, very thoroughly and are quite accurate. But the white light, or those white lines, I think, from the theory, is that it does reflect light to the eyes, and I think it is very, very accurate. It does help reflect a little bit more light to that eye so they can see better at night. This lion is yawning a lot, but he's not standing up for us just yet. Come on. Going to update some of the other guides that are out on game drive in the afternoon, tell them that we're still sitting with these lions. They are around. He's cleaning himself. Stations, just an update. These two coalition members are still lying up in the same position, just off Vuyatela Dam, out in the open. One station here. We're going to sit here a little bit longer and see if these males don't get up. Wonder what James is up to now.
We've come to Biffle's Hook Dam, everybody, and the hippopotamus is out of the water. Let me just drive up onto the wall quickly, and then you can have a look-see at him. He's just over there. And not alone, two hippopotami. One big fat one small fat one. And they're wandering off in search of something to eat. Now, while we look at them, everyone, you've very kindly sent through some words for me. I'm just going to get Rebecca to read them out to me again. So we had peaceful from Christina, Lynn and Monique. We had serene from another Lynn. Enthralled from Rob. And then we had a very interesting one, homesick, from Raisa. Now, that's actually what I was going for. And I don't know why I felt precisely the same thing, Raisa. And I think it's got something to do with the fact that the vegetation is wintry, the wind was blowing, and those dogs were sort of huddled there. And to me, it felt so very different from the summertime when it's so green and somehow so much brighter. And yes, there was a sense of real nostalgia about it for me, and an element of homesickness. Not that I don't feel at home here, but I don't know why that it conjured up some, you know, that exactly that feeling in me as well. So that's what I was going for. I don't see anything else particularly enthralling at the dam here. There's one irritated blacksmith lapwing going ding 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 ding. There we go. And I don't see any lions around here. I thought maybe there might be a lion or a male leopard. I haven't seen Tingana for a while. Right, let's go back to Byron and those male lions and see if they've deigned to get up, and hopefully they will start going roar, roar, roar louder than that very soon.
Yes, James, hopefully they do roar for us. Nice that you got a glimpse of that hippo leaving the water. That's great. And probably moving off to feed. But you see, we have had the one male stand up and still yawning, cleaning, scratching. All signs that they're going to become a little bit more active. The other one's head's back up again. Wow, it's a big yawn. I've asked the two males very nicely to roar for us. See what these males do. Oh, look at that, very affectionate. They always rub up against each other, the males and the coalitions. The reason for that is it just increases their bond between one another, helps strengthen that bond. Look at him, don't want to shine directly on the male's eyes. He may come and scent mark behind us here. Let's hope he doesn't spray on us. See, I wonder if he's going to head towards the waterhole. Now it's a case of who do we follow? This one or the one lying down? Let's follow this male. I'm sure the other one will follow shortly. This is what we wanted. This is exciting. We've got the males now on the move. I have to ask VM just to check behind us every now and then. I seem to be in the shot. I apologize. I'm trying to hide. Wonder where he's off to. The thickness of thickest. That's what VM says. We've still got one more behind us. Yeah, he's still there. Oh dear, he is going off into the thickness of thickest, VM. I don't know what. This is very thick. That's right down through that thick area towards that drainage line. We won't be able to follow him down there. But I think he's possibly just picked the most direct route for the area that he wants to go. Maybe he knows which direction that lioness went. Let's see, I wonder what he's found there. Can't really see. Buffalo or elephant dung. So it's possibly elephant dung and urine. I'm just trying to see. I can't really see too clearly. It just looks like there's a wet patch on that soil there. And the reason why this line is potentially rolling, or why it is rolling in that, is the scent, or their scent, is often masked by elephant dung or buffalo dung, and often you see predators going and rolling in it. So it's interesting. Very interesting behavior, but they do it often. Just trying to see if I can't. It's just a muddy patch there. Possibly something has just urinated, maybe elephant or buffalo, and they are rolling in it. Leopard do it too. The leopard also go and roll in the dung of buffalo or elephant. As I said, it helps mask their scent. Just want to scan off to the other side quickly. The other male hasn't moved yet. Very interesting behavior. These lions will now continue off and patrol their territory throughout the evening. They've had a good meal, so they don't have to eat really soon. They can go a day or so without food, but it's not to say they won't try and hunt or find food. They're very opportunistic, and if food comes along, they'll definitely eat. They'll never say no to a meal. Liz has asked us, is this the area that we think is potentially a denning lioness? No, this is not the area that we thought. We saw a lioness that we thought was potentially denning closer towards the Biffles Hook Dam, which, if I point it out now with the spotlight, let me see if VM can show it. In that direction, Liz, in that direction, not where we are now. We're quite close to the Vuyatela Dam, very close to camp. This is not the area we think the lioness is denning, or potentially going to den. So Zoe has asked us, do we usually see leopard and lions with cubs at the same time of year? No, we don't. So they can give birth any time of year. It all depends on when they've mated. So no, it will be throughout the year you have the potential chance of seeing leopard or lion with cubs. It all depends. What we're going to do, let's just head back to where that other lion was. This one seems to be lying down in the thicket over there now. Not interested in moving again. Let me just see where the other male is. I think he's still where we left him. Yeah, his head's up and he's still there. Let's go watch him for a little bit. Always got to watch where you're reversing. You might reverse into a deep donga or drainage line. Sneezing. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture of that lion. I think he can still hear those elephants moving through the thicket, and that's why he's looking in that direction. I'm hoping one of these males decides to roar. So Mike has asked us, what is the average age for a lion to live to? Oh, hang on. Let's listen. There we go, there we go. I think we're in for a roar. Come on, he's teasing us. He's definitely teasing us. Oh, I thought he was going to roar there. Oh, I hear the other one. Thought he gave a little call there too. So Mike, getting back to your question, how long do the, or what's the average age or life expectancy of a lion? For a male lion, it's about 10 to 12 years on average. For a lioness, it's about 14 to 15 years. Again, that's an average. Can be shorter, it can be longer. All depends on competition from other lions, if they get injured or not in fights. But generally, it's 10 to 12 years or 14 to 15 for females. Also, it depends. You know, males may live a little bit longer if they're in a successful coalition and they've got lionesses hunting in the area where they are very frequently and they're eating well. You could potentially live a bit longer, but that is an average age mark for males and females. It was very close to a roar. I thought he was starting there, but he just gave a low contact call. And then he stopped. Hang on, listen, listen, the other male's starting. Oh, come on, come on. Nice big stretch there. Actually heard his back click. There we go. More contact call. I just want to reverse quickly. Scent marking the same tree that his brother did. You can actually smell it. It smells a little pungent. Just caught a little whiff of it there. Oh, here we go, here we go. Come on. Even these little teasers, it's almost like they want to call, but they... There we go. The other one's starting to roar a little louder. I think this one will shortly. Come on. It's almost like they're just contact calling to one another. Going to give up just yet. See if they potentially hear other lions roaring, and their hearing is far better than ours. They hear other lions roaring in the distance. They will definitely return the roar or the call just to warn other lions that this is their territory. They are around here. So we may not hear it, but they possibly could. It's almost like those were just little contact calls or roars between these two males, just a very low call just to one another. But it's almost, I think they want to. They want to. I'm sure they're going to roar. So soon, I'm hoping. So Alice in Ohio has asked us how long those front canines are on the lions. Oh, come on. You can see they really are quite long there. I'm guessing about, what is that? 3 or 4 centimeters, I would say, somewhere around there. About 3 or 4 centimeters, I would say, Alice, probably. Maybe, but no, what's that? My measurements aren't very, very accurate. It's probably a bit more, closer to... No, I'd say between 3 and 5 centimeters, I would guess. As soon as I think they're going to roar, they stop. And the rest. But I'm sure this evening, if you keep watching on the dam cam, you might be able to hear them. We're just going to stay with these lions. We don't want to cross back to James and then you potentially miss these lions roar. Oh, there we go. There we go. Yes. Fantastic, we got a lion roar. That is awesome. That is what we've been waiting for. And as I said, our patience paid off. We sat here, we waited, and they started to call for us. We'll sit here a few more minutes. Well, we've only got a minute or so. James sends his farewell. And James and David on the other vehicle, thank you to them for a wonderful afternoon. Here with these lions, and I'm so happy we got to hear them roar right at the death. Just shows you patience pays off. Thank you very much to the ladies in final control. We had Rebecca and Chelsea this afternoon. Thank you very much for sending through the questions to us. I always refer to them as the voices in my head. It's great to hear them. And they always help us out with the questions. Let us know what each other are doing. I wonder if these lions are going to roar again. Don't forget to join us tomorrow morning again for another live safari, for our dawn safari. from myself, Byron, and Vim on camera. Thank you very much for joining us. Have a wonderful evening or day wherever you are in the world. Good night.